Hello and welcome to Emerald Heart Radio. It's Friday again, 6 p.m. Eastern, 11 p.m. Greenwich Mean Time, and the week seems to come round really quickly. And with a little luck, because Dave's been having problems with his internet this evening, but he's managed to get some super glue and some string, and he's holding it together, aren't you, Dave?
Just about. I've also got the aerial tied to a kite, so let's see what happens.
Normally me that has that problem.
It is, that's right, yeah. It's one of the of us, isn't it? Anyway, good evening to everybody, and as Alan says, welcome to Emerald Heart Radio. And we had a great show last week, didn't we, Alan?
It just seemed
to go in no time at all, the 2 half-hour segments. It was just amazing how fast it goes sometimes when the guidance is speaking through you.
Yes. I mean, it's like the guidance that came to me this week, saying, why believe? And I don't know where that's going to take us. I know you said you've written down some notes on it that came to you before we come on air, but those two words came, so be interested to know what you wrote down.
Yeah, well, I came into the office and plugged in. and I racked my brains. I thought, oh, what were those words? Oh, that's right, why believe? So I wrote them on a pad here, and then about 10 lines followed it straight away from guidance, and I thought, that's interesting. So the title of this week's show is Why Believe? And as I said to Alan just before the show, why bother?
Why bother? I like that. You do feel like that sometimes, don't you?
Well, we do. I mean, we had a good laugh. And, Alan and I are a little bit long in the tooth. We've been at it a while. And sometimes you get into these places where you really do think, well, why am I bothering with this? Why don't I just go and get a proper job?
Well, actually, it's funny you say that, right? Because I was approached by a lady to help her last week, distant work, and she paid the money into my account, and I did the work, and I don't know whether she was expecting some kind of miracle or something like that. So I said to her this evening, look, I'm not interested in all this. I'll tell you what, have your money back. And I paid her her money back literally about 2 minutes before I called you for us to have a pre-show chat. And I sent her a text message. I say, the money's back in your bank account. And I get a text message back off her saying, oh, thank you so much. Thank you so much. And I said, well, that's okay. No problem. But respectfully, I ask you not to contact me again. And I thought, and like you just said, why bother?
Yeah, why bother? Well, yeah. It's a tough one, isn't it, Alan? Because we know the work works because we've been doing it for years. And the only way we can ever judge our work is by the feedback. And go ahead.
No, say, and today I've been up to Leek in Staffordshire, and I've actually done healing on 3 greyhounds today. And the lady who asked me to go up, I've helped her before with her horses, and going back over a period of 2 years. Mm. And she said to me, I said, thank you for having the faith in me. She says, why wouldn't I, Alan? She says, I'd rather have you come to me and help me with me and my animals than anybody else. You know, I totally trust you. And then a few hours later, you've got a totally different scenario. So, yeah. I know that I do what I do just like you know what you do. And if it doesn't fit with somebody, then
yeah,
I don't mean it in the wrong way, but it is a problem with them that I can't do anything about.
Well, that's right. And in that kind of situation, what tends to happen is either a subconscious sabotage process that the person isn't aware of, where they're just not ready to move on from beyond that situation and they need to keep experiencing it. So, and the other thing is a lack of sensitivity. So some people will call in a practitioner like ourselves sometimes, expecting, you know, the all singing, all dancing miracle. And that miracle may well have taken place, but on such a subtle level that they can't perceive it. And so on the one hand, you can spend some time in helping them to see what's actually happened. And that's what I do with evolutionary cases. And I'll give you an example, which is really funny. Many, many, many years ago, this. And a chap had come to me. He was a Reiki practitioner, and he'd got some issues or some problems, and I can't really remember what they were, to tell you the truth now. And at the end of the session, I'd sent him away with some essence to take for 4 weeks, and I said, then we'll have a follow up and let's see what's happened after that 4 weeks. So I know that the essences always blow the socks off people. and I started this follow-up session and I said, well, you know, what did you experience during this week? And he said to me, absolutely nothing. I'm really sorry to tell you, but I've never felt a thing at all. So I thought, well, that's strange, you know. And this was the guidance teaching me. So I went through a few scenarios with him. I said, well, I'll tell you what we're going to do. Let's leave it another 3 or 4 weeks. And let's have another follow-up and see what's happened in that period of time. So the guidance was telling me that the guy had experienced a change. So I knew it had worked, but he was adamant that nothing was happening. But he was very nice about it. So another 4 weeks went by, and it was the same situation. He hadn't felt a single thing. And then I said, okay, well, let's give it one last shot. Let's leave it another 3 weeks. And let's see, has anything happened then? Because the guidance was telling me it's still unfolding in his system and it's still bringing changes, Dave. So the third follow-up, so we're like 11 weeks down the line now. And I answered the phone and he says, I'm really, really sorry, Dave. He says, but I haven't felt a single thing. And the guidance said to me, ask him how his Reiki is. So I said, how is your Reiki? He said, oh, it's absolutely amazing. You wouldn't believe it. It's so strong. He said, even after the first session we had together within 2 or 3 days, he said, I could hardly be in the same room with the clients. It was like just light was blasting out of me all over the place. So, you know, he'd had the essence. Within 3 days, he'd had this phenomenal miracle happen with his healing, and he just hadn't put the two and two together. And so what the guidance was teaching me in that situation is, Dave, it always works, but sometimes you've got to ask them a few questions to get them to see where it's worked so you can get the answers out of them and get into the consciousness and help them to see it.
So so I think it's very apt. The title for today's show, Why Believe, and that can be in all different contexts, can't it? People are looking for answers. And you have your beliefs, I have mine. They tend to be very close. But then other people's are totally the other end of the spectrum. It's quite amazing, really, how we all of us can be so different yet searching for the same thing.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. Well, I'll read to you what I wrote on the pad and we can go through this and dissect it. So I've mentioned this before on the show once when we were doing a similar subject. I can't remember the title of it. But sometimes people say to me, you know, do you believe this, Dave, or do you believe that, or, you know, what's your beliefs? My answer to that is I don't believe in anything. I only have knowledge of my own experiences. So once I'd written that on the pad, the following came through the guidance, which is kind of just reminding me what I already know, really. So, however, even though I don't believe in anything, there can be feelings of possibility without the actual knowledge. So the key word here is the knowing or the knowledge. So knowing is about truth, and truth is all that there is. So once you have experienced truth, then you have the knowing, and the knowing comes from the heart. The heart is the truth center or the knowing center. And in your heart, you feel and experience the truth. And when you have this absolute knowing, it blows belief out of the water. So there's belief, faith, and trust, we might say. And then there's knowing and truth. And when you absolutely know the truth, the others just pale into insignificance next to those two words, knowing and truth. So if we think about belief, we think about faith, and we think about trust, they're based on the possibilities. So what we might say about the possibilities is, you know, we grow up in family groups, and those family groups might be, you know, religious families. So you're brought up in a faith of a church, for example, and you go to church and you do your worship, and you have the faith that there is something there that you're actually speaking to. What we experience, Alan, in the kind of work we're doing is the absolute truth and the knowing of what we do.
Yes,
because
right.
if we do A, B happens. It's as simple
yes.
as that. And that's based on universal law. So when you learn how the universal laws work, you know that if you practice a certain thing, you will absolutely get a certain result. And that word absolutely is what it's all about. It's an absolute. It's an absolute reflection from the universe of what
well, you
we
see
practice.
The, see, the truth is totally, as you say, it's totally different from belief. A belief,
yeah.
You, as you say, isn't proven to yourself. You just believe.
Yeah.
Once you've had different things happen and given the knowledge, then it goes beyond belief, yes.
Yeah. Beyond belief, mate.
Yes,
there's another subject.
Well, yes. It's funny, you know, you, going back to what I said about refunding this lady's money,
yeah.
You know, some years ago, that would have really worried me. In a way, it to me now, I'm mentioning it simply because it's like, well, I knew it's the right thing to do, and I knew that I'd done what I meant to do. And as you said, for whatever reason, that person isn't ready.
That's right.
So, you know.
Well, it's all about energetic contract. So she'd made an exchange in you as part of an energetic contract, and you'd done a piece of work in exchange for that energy, the energy
yeah.
which was the money, yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
You know you've done a good job. You know it works, et cetera, et cetera. But this lady, for whatever reason, can't experience the change. So, you know, I do exactly the same. If I ever have anybody, and it's very, very rare, but if I ever have anybody where they can't feel or appreciate a change on some level through no fault of their own other than they're not sensitive enough usually, then I refund all the money, and that's the end of the contract. Nothing has happened. Nothing has changed at all. So, you know, you refund the money, and then there's it nullifies the contract, the energetic contract. And so there's no karma anywhere. You've done
yes.
your best. They didn't experience the best. And so
yeah.
you refund the exchange, and everything goes back to normal in the karmic picture. Yeah, and it's an easy process, and you know it's nobody's fault that they can't feel it. So you know you just be as nice as you possibly can and say, okay, here we go. What I'm actually going to do is refund all your money. So you've had the benefit of a consultation, you've had the benefit of the work. You might actually start feeling it in 3 or 4 weeks, but I tell you what, it doesn't matter. You have all the money back. That's fine.
Yeah.
You move on. I'll move on.
Well, I put in the text. I hope you find a solution to your problems.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, but you see, what happens is you can quite easily get into some kind of an entanglement with it. And then you get situations where you can be accused of, conning them or, you know, and all kinds of things. And if somebody is in that situation, in their mindset, it doesn't matter what you say to them, you won't alter that thought pattern.
That's so, right, because that's their belief.
Right. So isn't it funny? We didn't know what we were going to be talking about why believe. And this evening, something happens that literally gives the weight to the topic.
That's right, yeah, absolutely, yeah. So coming back to the difference between faith and belief really being the two key words and the opposing forces, which is knowing and truth, what we come down to is the ability of the heart, like the consciousness within the heart, to perceive the truth. And for the vast majority of humanity, the heart isn't developed enough to a point where they're so connected with it, they can appreciate the truth. And when your heart is open at that level, you experience the truth at quite a dramatic level. It can be quite intense most of the time. So the heart, or the heart chakra, but the deeper consciousness in the heart, essentially deals with three things. It deals with truth, it deals with fear, and it deals with courage. So fear is the thing that limits the expansion of the heart and the consciousness. So this is where people stay in their same patterns day after day after day, because the overriding program that's functioning within them is fear of change. So that's where your fear comes in. And then what happens when you start to work with somebody who can bring light into your life is that the light starts to awaken the courage and helps them to go through and dissolve the fear that limits them. And in that process, they then start to touch into a higher level of truth. And that's the path of the evolution of consciousness within the heart. So it's interesting looking at people's different perspectives on what they think evolution is, or evolution of humanity. You know, people think it's in the mind or in the brain or something, and it isn't. It's all based in the heart. Everything is heart-based where the consciousness is concerned. So, you know, we have some people that are very left-brain orientated. They run on that kind of left-brain program. And the people on the right-brain program, you know, they're flopping around all over the place at the mercy of their emotions and their feelings most of the time. Where the left brain people tend to be functioning from the head and very cut off from the heart. Having said that, you can get a crossover in those people at any point. So the left brain person can experience the emotional side in the heart, and the right brain person can experience a separation from the heart and that pure stream of mind consciousness, if you like. But, you know, as guidance has always shown me, the trick is to separate the mind, treat the mind as an entity. Guidance calls it an entity, the entity of mind. It says the mind has its own agenda for your life, whether you like it or not, and it can become very, very powerful. And what we have to try and do is calm that or separate from it. And in that separation, the heart becomes stronger, and then you become more connected with the truth and the knowing. And you go beyond the need for faith or belief because you step into the knowing.
Actually, I don't know if you can see in the chat room, Dave, but questions there. Can we specify what this broadcast is about? It feels quite generic at the moment. Well, I see that this particular program is about why us as individuals believe in a certain way, and different things that happen to us that perhaps quantify that belief. And it's about learning from those that belief to see whether you're right in what you believe in your analysis, or whether there's something else there that can show you the truth, the light. Would that sum it up, do you think, Dave?
Yeah, I think that sums it up, yeah. The key words of the show are why believe. So where we're exploring the aspects of belief and faith, trust, knowing, and truth, essentially. And if you step back into belief and faith for a moment, they come from a place of possibility. So, you know, people have a strong faith and a strong belief sometimes that they know something's there, but it's not tangible for them because they haven't had the opportunity to work at a deeper level with light and experience the truth of what the power of spirit or the power of universal consciousness can actually do in the hands of humans when we apply ourselves to playing with those forces, for want of a better description. But the other important thing is, from my own experience, is that you can't prove God. It's an impossibility. It's a trust process. And the more you step into trusting everything that happens to you and trying to figure out, you know, why some apparently bad things happen sometimes, but there is no such thing as a bad thing or a negative thing. It's always a process of being a learning experience. And so as we step through those learning experiences and we have something that's difficult to deal with and we ask questions, the moment you start to ask the universe questions, okay, why is this happening to me? Then, you know, you start to get answers. But until you ask the question, the universe won't answer it because it's working on a universal law of reflection.
I'm sorry, Dave. There's a question there by the same person saying truth about what? Well, the way I see that
truth.
One.
Yeah, just it's truth. It's
just truth of.
It's universal truth.
Yeah, of our existence, I suppose.
Yeah.
There can't be any greater truth of actually knowing what we are or what we are part of.
Yeah. So, if we think about truth of what, it's just about the truth of experience. What is your experience? How do you manifest your experiences? How do you create your experiences? So, for example, you know, I've been playing around with some experiments this past 12 months or so with the universe. It's kind of pointed me in a certain direction and said, Dave, have a play with this kind of stuff over here. So, and it's playing with stuff in the physical world rather than playing with things in our spiritual lives. And, I'll give you a clear example of what it is. I have a passion, as you know, Alan, for classic cars and just messing about with old things in general. I'm pretty old myself.
I'm older than you, so watch it.
I thought you were younger than me. I always think you're younger than me. Anyway, I have a passion for finding rare parts for particular classic cars. And just last week, I thought, you know what? I'd like to find one of these engines. Now, they only made 2,000 of these engines back in the 60s, and half of those have disappeared into scrap yards, and they're absolutely impossible or almost impossible to find. Within a week, I'd found one. And not only that, I'd got a good price to buy it at as well. So that was, you know, it's absolute manifestation. It's like, the thought came. Oh, where did that thought come from? Okay, then I'll chase that thought down. Let's see. Let's speak to a few people. Let's send a few emails out and see what comes back. Yeah. And an email came back to tell me about one of these engines that had been sat in a shed for 25 years. So, you know, I spoke to the guy and said, okay, well, is it going to sit there for another 25 years or are you going to sell it to me? and you know, that was manifested. This rare thing was manifested. In just about a week, in actual fact. So
I do totally understand that because, you know, the car that I've got now, you know, the Rover 75.
Yeah.
I really like the Rover 75, and you know, I've stopped making them, you know, quite a few years ago, but I really like this car. And I used to say to Anne, I'd love a Rover 75, perhaps one day I'll have one. And it happened, you know. Yeah. In fact, Anne's dad, out of the blue, bought me a car, and he said, which car do you want? And I went, well, Rover 75, okay. So I didn't ask. I just asked the universe, perhaps someday I'll be able to have a Rover 75. And I've had that car now for over 7 years. And it, as far as I'm concerned, that's it. I don't care how old it is, you know. So I think sometimes we do get what we want. That's on a selfish basis, wanting that car. You know, I mean, it depends on how you look at it. I certainly didn't go around saying to everybody, I want a Rover 75, just to Anne. She didn't say anything to her dad, but just out of the blue, could we be, you know, we'd helped him. And so I don't want anything for helping you, Fred. Yeah. But he was quite insistent, and he felt quite hurt. I was going to say no. So what do you do?
Well, that's right. Well, you have to learn to accept.
Yes. That's right.
Yeah. So I think we're going to a break, aren't we, Alan?
You are. Yes, right, we are. It's break time. Quickly before we do, just give the website out for Emerald Heart, Dave.
The Emerald Heart blog is all the W's, emeraldheartlight.com.
That's good. And mine is calmingthoughts.com. So we'll have the break now. Welcome back to Emerald Heart Radio. This is Alan Fox, your one host, and Dave Ashworth is on the other end of the line. Before we carry on with what we were talking about on the break, Dave, there's a really, I think, a very good question that's just been posted up by Alicia in the chat room. And she says, I was wondering something. We all have our different beliefs, but in the end, there is one general core. And for many of us, there is no need to prove it. But when you deal with people who want you to provide some support evidence, what do you usually do?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a good question.
I think it is. That's why I thought it was worth reading out.
Well, as she rightly says, there's no need to prove it. But what I used to do when I was a healer was, I would do a pretty in-depth reading. I mean, my work has always been based on consciousness and looking deep into the consciousness to find the underlying patterns that create certain situations. And I would, you know, dig the patterns out, and I would read for the person. And I absolutely knew that I was reading the truth, because I'm reading it out of literally the core of their heart. So I'm reading their truth from the core of their heart. So I'm putting this truth on the table for them, and it comes out in such a way that they can't deny that is their truth. They absolutely know it is their truth. But even though they know it's the truth, we say, okay, here's the truth, we've got it on the table, now how can we change this pattern? So then what I'll do is I'll go through a process of saying, well, if we do this and this will dissolve this certain energy. That will allow you to move through a shift, a transformation. You come out the other side, and you'll find that you're not limited by that same energy. And sometimes when you speak into a person, you can feel them absolutely going into the denial. You know that you're telling them the truth. They know they're hearing the truth, but they're going into a place where they don't actually want to feel it. And so I reach a point where I say to them, look, I'm not trying to sell you this. This is up to you to know it's the truth and take the appropriate action. So what I suggest is to some people is that they go away and think about it for a week. And as soon as they come to a conclusion, let me know whichever way it is. But some people are just not ready to move through that level of truth at that point in time, because it means changing too much. They can't change it. So it's not about proving something to somebody, because you've laid it on the table and they absolutely know the truth of it. But you can't get them to jump up and grab that truth sometimes because they're too fearful of doing that and going through the change. So, you know, it's the same. If somebody came to one of my talks, for example, and said to me, well, can you, let's speak about earth acupuncture, for example. Can you prove this works to me? I'm not here to waste energy in trying to prove it. Because you could spend days, weeks, months, years trying to prove something to somebody. If they can't feel the truth of what you're actually saying at that moment in time, then you're not going to go anywhere with that person. So, you know, sometimes people will say to you, for example, well, I'm a skeptic and I'm not sure I believe in any of this. Well, that's fine. You'd be a skeptic. I'm not the one to waste my time and energy proving that to you. Are you with me, Alan?
I am now.
So you disappear
just,
then.
I've got one of these dongles, and I thought, well, if my internet connection's gone off my router, I'll put it on the dongle. But it came back on before I got that set up. So
good. Yeah.
And it was you who was having the difficulties beforehand.
That's right, yeah. So we were just speaking, when you disappeared, we were speaking about people that come up sometimes and say, well, I'm a skeptic, can you prove this to me? And, my life is my life. I've only got a finite amount of time and energy, and I don't have the time and energy to explain these things to people. But if they really want to know, get involved. Get involved and start playing with the energy and the light, and you'll find out the truth for yourself when it starts playing with you. You know, sorry, Alan, go ahead, yeah?
No, I was going to say, Dave, you know, when you know it's the truth and it's just not a belief,
yeah.
In some ways, okay, it's still good to listen to other people, their experiences,
yeah.
How they look at life.
Yeah.
But when you know the truth, it's like nothing can shake you.
No,
you know,
it's an absolute knowing. Yeah,
that's right. You know, so yeah. That I think that's the difference between a belief and and the knowledge.
That's right. Yeah, it is. It is. It's a fundamental. They're poles apart, really. Belief is based on. Possibilities, and it's also based on feelings that something might be true. It's also based on programming where you're brought up, where people say, you know, I remember being brought up and I was always in trouble with a lad, and my mum used to say to me, God is watching you, he's absolutely everywhere. I couldn't find him though. I looked under the chairs and under the bed and in the other room, and the concept, I couldn't compute the concept at all that God was watching me all the time. But of course, as a young lad, you know, you start to think, oh, well, perhaps I better not do this. I better not misbehave in case this lad called God is watching me. So, you know, we can grow up controlled by those thoughts. And those thoughts are very much tied in with belief. And you believe certain things because you've been programmed by your elders, if you like, with those thoughts. So, so belief and truth are these two things which are absolutely poles apart. But the only way you can ever prove to yourself, so back into the proof again, the only way that you can ever prove these things to yourself is to get hands-on with the light and the energy, and it will be your teacher. That is the teacher. It's not so much a person being the teacher. The light is the teacher.
So how did you find the truth of the Emerald Heart?
Well, the morning it came, which was either, I can never remember, but it was either 28th or 29th of January 2005, when I woke up and I sat up in bed, just about to get out of bed, and this ray of light hit me so hard in the heart and in the forehead that, you know, it just stuns you. When you, the first question you ask yourself is, God, what on earth is that? You know, and at the same time, you can feel it burning deep into you. So it hits you in the heart and it starts to tear the heart open at new levels. And I remember the first, you know, 4 weeks, it was like I was just on fire inside. So, you know, you don't have to ask any questions. You know that something is kind of ripping you apart, dissolving certain aspects of the ego, and pulling out from within you aspects of your own truth. And, you know, in those phases, I went through, I began to see through the illusion, basically, the light. There was that much light within me for that first 6 months after it hit me, that I was starting to see through the illusion. So, you know, we read about the illusion, and we read about reality being very different from the illusion. And I began to see through this, through the illusion, I began to see the planet Earth and what humanity had done to it. And I remember being taken out into the universe on a journey. And I was, when you go out on these journeys, they just take your consciousness out of the heart. And it's just like elastic, if you like. You're still here, fully conscious, but another part of you is being taken out into the universe. And you're seeing in fifth dimension, so you're seeing all aspects of everything at the same time. When that first starts to happen to you, it's quite overwhelming, and it makes you quite dizzy. I'll just give you an idea of what seeing in fifth dimension is like. If you imagine you were sitting inside a car, say it had one seat, and the seat was right in the very center of the car, what you can actually see is everything in 360 degrees in all directions around you inside that car. But you can also see everything from outside the car in all directions as well. So it's like you become everywhere outside the car while also being able to see everything within the car. And it's quite disconcerting when it first starts to happen, but then things unfold and you get a grip of it. So when you're starting to see in kind of fifth dimension, it takes you on quite an amazing journey. And this one particular journey, I was taken away from the Earth, and it was interesting. I could see a ring in the sky, like a circle, like a ring. And I was dragged into this ring, or positioned into this ring, just like the Vitruvian man with his arms and his legs, like in this cartwheel, if you like. It's like my arms and legs were riveted to this ring, and spirit started to turn me round towards the Earth. And even before I could see the Earth, I went into such overwhelming fear, because I knew what they were going to show me. And there's only one way you could know this, and that's because you've seen it before in the past, not in this life, but in at some other level of consciousness, in some previous existence, possibly at a much higher vibrational level than I was at that moment in time.
There's a question there. How can you get started with the truth? How to get involved in a practical level?
Yeah. Okay, I'll answer that question in a second. So, as they turned me around to see the Earth, what I actually saw was this beautiful living being that was just putrefaction. It was rotting and dying, and that's what humanity has done to it. So what I was seeing was the energetic imprint of the Earth. So we still see it in all its beauty, with its trees and its flowers and people walking all over the surface. But it's all the detritus and the energy they've dropped into it from their own emotions. And the Earth was sinking and dying from this process. Now, when you see something like that, it hits you so hard, because you're actually seeing the truth of a situation, that it takes you months and months to get over it. It's like how can I carry on living like this when, you know, in this world which is dying, etc. But eventually you come back into your balance. So there's a question that says, how can we get started on learning to see the truth? Right. Essentially, you work with a teacher who can start to unlock it within you. But there's also many ways you can start prior to that. So, for example, if you think about the bark flower remedies, if you learn to douse and you start working with bark flower remedies on a daily basis, the bark flower remedies over a period of time will start to dissolve out certain limiting factors in your energy system. So bark remedies tend to work on what we call the energetic system, which is the chakras and the aura. So three primary levels of the aura, basically, which is the emotional body, the mental body, and the spiritual body. And what those do is reflect onto the physical body. So if you start to work with these bark remedies, what they'll do is start to cleanse and dissolve out various heavy energies within the aura and within the chakras. And, you know, you might work on that for maybe 12 months to do a serious amount of cleansing. Then you can move to more potent things. So if you work with a practitioner or somebody, or perhaps a shamanic worker, who has the ability to see into your consciousness. So, for example, what we do in the Emerald Heart, we look for something that is called the prime limiting factor to your evolution. And what that means is the prime limiting factor is the one single thing that stops your vibration moving to the next level, moving upwards. Now, once your vibration moves up, it can't ever come back down again, because we only do evolution. We only go one way. We don't do devolution. We don't come back down. So once your vibration moves up the ladder a short space, it stays up there. It might fluctuate up and down a little bit, but it can never come back down to that previous place. So what an Emerald Heart practitioner will do is look for this prime limiting factor. So it might be that you have, you know, we've all got many hundreds of issues, and the more you walk the spiritual path, the deeper the issues you dig up. It's almost like there's no end to it sometimes, or it seems that way. So there's only ever one of these issues at one moment in time that is preventing you shifting to another level of consciousness. And if we can find that, and it's usually based in fear, so it's a fear of some description or other, if we can find that, we can target the energy of that fear with a very powerful essence, a vibrational essence, similar to bark remedies, but much more potent, then we can dissolve that little cloud of energy, and you will feel the shift very, very quickly. Now, evolution is a journey. It's not a quick fix. You're not trying to fix something. You're merely trying to unlock consciousness. And the more you unlock the consciousness, the more you start to see beyond the illusion and into the reality and the truth. And one of the first signs of this, which is quite funny in a way, is you lose all your friends.
Yes.
Because yes, as your vibration shifts, you suddenly find that you can't tolerate their vibration anymore.
I'll tell you something, Dave, right? Because my all of my life, when I've got friends, then to me they are real friends, and I will help them in any way that I'm able to. Yet I've noticed throughout my life, when I've altered my job, did different things, I have never fallen out with anybody who were friends, but yeah, I've moved on from them.
And yeah, that's right.
And then a new set of friends, and it's peculiar. And you just saying that now, I've just thought about it. That's how I've been all my life.
Yeah. Well, it's based on the law of reflection. Whatever vibration you're putting out into the universe is attracting people of a similar vibration. Now, if you're working spiritually, your vibration is changing all the time. So you're going to, you know, attract new people into your life. But also you're going to move beyond. You just move beyond. They might be very good friends for a short period in time, and you move on or they move on, but it's all based on the vibration, and that's all based on the law of reflection. So to answer, just briefly to answer another aspect of that question, in the guidance that I give in our blog about once every 6 weeks, it's probably due now any time actually, the guides will take me into the universe and give me the next phase of guidance. Yeah. We also produce an essence at that time, and it's called the essence of the period. So the guidance speaks about the universe in periods. It says, okay, we're going into a new period. These are the vibrations of the universe. So what we're going to do, Dave, is give you an essence which is totally linked into the shifting vibration of the universe. And if a person takes this essence, it's like linking them into the universe, and the universe begins to accelerate them. It's like catching a bus, really. The bus is coming down the road. You stick your hand out and you get on it, and it takes you to the next stop. So what the universe is showing me is, here's the vibration that's bathing the Earth realm at this moment, Dave. We're going to give you the bus, which is like the essence. Yeah. Get on the bus, take this essence, and the universe will pull you along. So this is a very, very potent way. And if a person takes that essence of the period for three or four periods, they'll certainly notice quite powerful shifts. I mean, I have people that have been taking this essence for maybe, you know, 5 or 6 years, and their whole lives are completely transformed. And it's just from that, because they haven't done any other spiritual work with anybody else.
Believe it or not, we're virtually out of time again.
Again.
Yeah, again. Doesn't it go really quickly?
Yeah. It feels like it's been a good show again tonight.
I believe it has, yeah. And it's good to see quite a few people in the chat room and asking some very good questions. Yeah. So I do thank you for that, because it's good to have interaction. And that's what the show is all about, is giving information and hopefully putting it over so people understand it, you know. So, yeah.
Helping people to find their own path in life. And the way you find your own path in life is by unfolding the truth within you.
That's right.
And, sorry, go ahead, Alan.
So it's that time for us to thank everybody in internet land, radio land, and in the chat room for listening for the hour. And God willing, we'll both be back again next week, won't we, Dave?
I hope so.
Yes, same here. All right. So over to you then.
Yeah, so in the meantime, you can read about Emerald Heart in the blog, which is emeraldheartlight.com. And you're at calmingthoughts.com, Alan.
That's right, it is. Yep.
And until next week, it's good night from me.
And it's good night from him.
Good night.